So the whole conference today is going to be on a digital hybrid mode, right? So I don't need to emphasize the importance of digital health and digital conferencing right now that's happening here. One second, let me just make sure my slide is. I'm not able to
go down and you can
yeah. I'm on a Zoom window.
Ma'am, you just go minimize your Zoom window. Or just do nothing, just go to share a screen. You'll get many options there. On the Zoom, this green icon down here.
No, I'm not able to press on the on my slideshow.
Okay. You go on the slide.
Yeah, that window is
see. Ma'am, just refresh it. Yes, just refresh it.
Yeah, just refresh it.
Yeah.
And ma'am, in this, just select the slide.
Okay.
Do not click on the share. Just
yeah,
stop
yeah.
it.
Hold on a second.
Yes. Now it's okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Now it's perfect, ma'am.
Yes.
You can continue.
So so the whole conference today is going to be on a hybrid mode, right? I mean, you can see me on a hybrid mode right now, right? I'm virtual, and part of our attendees are on site in Goa and part of us are here. So digital health has been just, it has come to us overnight, right? When the pandemic hit us, we all became extremely tech savvy and digital. We just moved our practices to digital way partly, and part of it was on site. So let's look at how this boon has helped us during this pandemic. So let me start with the scope of digital health. What is digital health? Most of us know it. Digital health is a convergence of technology in healthcare to enhance health. To describe digital health as a large platform where, let me talk about, just for the sake of the talk, I've divided it into multiple subsets of digital health. M-health is mobile health. We'll talk through this during this session. Telehealth and telemedicine forms another arm of the digital health. Healthcare information technology it encompasses the whole, expands through the digital health, but it is an extremely important topic, so I do want to touch on it. Artificial intelligence, wearable devices, and the IoTs or the Internet of Things. So like what they were saying, I mean, Honorable Prime Minister has, they have, you know, Ministry of Health and Family Healthcare. They have gone large on mHealth or mobile health, where access, even in the rural communities, ensured through the mobile health. Dr. Suresh Kumar earlier was telling us how we can use his help from wherever we are, irrespective of wherever we are living in a urban or a rural area, and have access to high-tech, high-tech help and also expert help. So mHealth, as you know, is mobile health. Anything that is accessible on a mobile phone. I mean, that it doesn't necessarily need a smartphone, but of course, most of the part is on a smartphone. It can be linked, links can be sent through the mobile phones, and then you can get access to information. So National Health Portal of India, that is a large portal where you can have, you know, the mobile, it acts as a mobile extension to the National Health Portal via the mean, Government of India has made it large now. It features a UI where it is accessibility to and discovery of health information for even including farmers or wherever they are, right, in the rural area also. Of course, the AIIMS, WHO collaboration has come up with a mobile health platform to help the nursing colleagues and the neonatologists from the regions where there is poor accessibility, where you can have access to the maternal and the fetal health. Then there are a number of plethora of mHealth applications that are available these days. I mean, there are a lot of private firms that have come up with mHealth applications. I mean, I'm not naming any private companies here, but there are so many applications that people, especially patients, can download as well as the healthcare professionals can be part of, where exchange of health information and exchange of also to get access to our healthcare can be delivered. So mHealth, it's quite intuitive. Most people understand this. Telemedicine and telehealth. This is also very intuitive. I mean, telemedicine, who doesn't know telemedicine these days in the era of pandemic, right? So Government of India has launched e-Sanjeevani OPD schemes where patients, especially patients have COVID and they don't want to travel, and healthcare professionals also feel like, you know, you can't cater to a large number of COVID outpatient, COVID patients. So patients in the remote location or wherever they are, they can log into e-Sanjeevani and get expert opinions on the virtual OPD that is delivered from the telemedicine platform. That is called e-Sanjeevani OPD. Now, what is the difference between, I would like to emphasize the important, the difference between the telemedicine and telehealth. Telehealth refers to broader aspect of the telemedicine, right? So telemedicine is just the patient on one side, doctor on the other side, and they are delivering care to the patient. Telehealth involves all the non-clinical services too, which remote delivery of test kits, for example, remote management of patients through their vital signs monitoring. The non-clinical part of the doctor-patient relationship is also included under telehealth. Health IT. Health IT, the term healthcare information technology refers to the electronic systems the healthcare professionals and patients use to store, share, and analyze health information. Now, the health information technology is a large platform where the electronic health records part one form of it. The arm that the physicians use, for example, is the EHR part. We call that electronic health records. I mean, the health record aspect that we use to store our patient's information, track the patient information, their vital signs, their lab reports, their CT scans, x-rays, everything is stored by us and accessed by the healthcare professionals. And we can share this EHR to a specialist. Let's say we need an ID consult, for example. And then we share this part of the electronic health record. It's shared so that the other specialists can have access to the same information that we have, so that we don't have to say the same thing again. Now, personal health records is one part of the health IT that is managed by the patient. So patients can store their records instead of them bringing us a bundle of their records. Like most patients bring us a bundle of paper and we are expected to peruse through that, in about 5 minutes, right, of time that we have with the patient. So it's almost impossible. But personal health records is one part. They can bring it so that they can show us the trends. They show us the LDL has gone up, you know, they'll show us, doctor, something is going wrong with my weight. Something is going wrong. You know, maybe I didn't exercise enough because my diet has changed these days and my exercise routine has changed. So they can show you the trend. The patients bring this with us and they have a trend, and we can also view it as a summary view. So personal health record is becoming a new fad now because most patients turning to electronic devices and also smart watches. They're wearing a lot of devices these days, and they can track their health information and they can share it as needed to the physician. E-prescribing, all of you know, it is a part of this whole telemedicine, telehealth aspect where the prescription is delivered electronically either to the pharmacy or to the patient. Now, one important aspect of this whole health IT is the privacy and security. because healthcare, as we all know, it is a very personal information and cannot be shared. It has to be encrypted, which means nobody other than the intended person who's supposed to see our personal health information can see it. This is where 2022, blockchain is making a major, advancement here in terms of locking up our privacy and security so that our health information is not our meaning. Patient's health information is not, it cannot be hacked. It cannot be, it's not going and sitting somewhere else, and the data cannot be used for other purposes also. Coming to AI, this is something that is very pet to me. AI, artificial intelligence, is simulation of human intelligence in the machines. I've done some work in the AI field, and we published a recent paper on the COVID and chest radiographs. We published a paper on the adoption of AI. This was way back before COVID came. We analyzed how much physicians or clinicians are willing to adopt artificial intelligence in their clinics. Now, even the pre-pandemic era, physicians, I was surprised to see that when we surveyed 200 physicians across 200 clinicians across the world, not only just in India, most of them were willing to accept or adopt artificial intelligence and telemedicine. This is pre-pandemic. They were willing to adopt, provided it was reliable and they were, they could be convinced that it is useful to them. As long as it's useful, as long as it's valid and it has been approved, some kind of validation has gone through, people were willing to adopt. Now, AI during the COVID era, something that has, thrown a lot of light is the AI. And with more and more data coming in from the electronic health records, AI is becoming the new helper in the healthcare sector. I would like to mention this point about the Canadian company called Blue Dot, which purported to be the first organization to disclose the possibility of a COVID-19 outbreak. I mean, it didn't say COVID-19. They predicted this outbreak to occur way in December 2019, by using machine learning and natural language processing. Now, ML and NLP are just arms of the AI. Now, let's look at where all AI has entered during COVID. One is the diagnostic imaging part, chest radiographs. I mean, chest radiographs, most people with less training in chest radiography, people who are, especially the junior doctors who cannot, they've not seen hundreds of radiographs to detect COVID-19. But with our model that we kind of use from the open source platform, we use the ChestNet platform, and then we tried curating our own chest x-rays. We fed the model our own chest x-rays curated by me and another radiologist, and we got 91.5% to detect COVID-19 on chest radiography, to detect COVID on chest radiographs. Similarly, there are chest CT analysis that, the advantage of AI is that you don't have to wait for a radiologist to give you a report. You attach your CT scan, and you get the immediate instantaneous results regarding the severity of COVID-19. Because it's instantaneously read by the model, and you don't have to wait for the radiograph.
Ma'am, you have very less time to finish up. You have just 2 minutes.
Yes. So even in the epidemiology of COVID, AI has helped tremendously. Therapy of COVID-19, vaccinology and immunology, they have AI has helped them come up with models or molecules that can help with the cure of COVID. Wearable devices. Everybody knows smart watches, smart mask with active filtration by virus killing UV light, functions as a voice amplifier also. Smart mask, head-mounted wearables that can, with AR and VR, that is augmented reality and virtual reality, is coming up in a large way that helps reduce stress of patients. Smart yoga pants that can tell you the posture of the patient, and swimsuits also are embedded with smart technology these days. Smart watches can give you pulse oximetry readings and as well as the ECG readings as well. Coming to IoTs, IoTs is kind of encompasses the smart devices that we spoke about. It describes a network of physical objects, things that are embedded with sensors, software, and other technologies for the purpose of connecting and exchanging data. Now, during the COVID-19, thermal screening has been introduced in the airport so that you can, once the patient with the temperature passes through, you can track them. And that is where IoT helps. Facial recognition, including even when they are wearing masks, I mean, you to identify people who have, and track them. Biometrics have come up a long way too. So glucose monitoring devices connected to apps, one example of Internet of Things. Also, in the ICU settings, IoTs help to manage, monitor the patient positions and also medical staff, to know what's going on from a remote position, location. So IoTs and smart devices have come up a long way. So to summarize this, major changes the pandemic brought about in digital health, mHealth, this kind of becomes sine qua to health these days. Adoption of telemedicine happened almost overnight when COVID hit. AI entering mainstream, and IoTs are still blooming. IoTs are still very early phase these days, but IoTs are set to bloom in the next couple years. Contactless technologies have almost universal adoption when COVID came. Now, IoTs have a large headwind to go in the next couple years. Wearables have become almost become mandatory to our existence these days. So with that, I summarize the major changes the pandemic has brought about in digital health, and also how digital health has helped us, not just in pandemic and also in the years to come. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to talk about digital health.